Okay, so welcome to part two in the video series or saga on the OpSpot Tail Air webcam. It's a PTZ 4K webcam. It also supports 1080p 60. The interesting thing, if you watch the first part of the video, is it's completely wireless. It's got basically a computer built into its base, so it can do everything it needs to do. It can connect over a Wi-Fi network and go through into apps like OBS through things like RTSP and MP, NDI, even VSCA protocol. So it has the ability to wirelessly stream into those apps as well as into different services that can take a direct feed from the camera like Twitch or like YouTube or like LinkedIn. So you can actually use this camera as a standalone device, and it's got its own built-in microphone array, which I tested in part one, which sounds pretty good. And the image from it is also really good in terms of being able to hold its own compared to, say, a mirrorless camera, which that camera by definition is also mirrorless. It won't be able to do things like swappable lenses. It does, however, support things like ND filters and the like. So this part two, is gonna mainly focus on the software experiences and also go a little bit longer in terms of my overall opinion of the OpSpot Tail Air. All right, so one thing I do want to spend significant time on, and I don't think a lot of other reviewers or people trying this out are going to spend a lot of time on, is the OpSpot Start app. So there is a lot of functionality built into that mobile app, and that's what you're going to do and what you're going to use basically to find all your streaming settings for video. You're going to be setting the video configurations, all those different things, what the preferences are to switch it from UVC to a wireless camera. All of that's done from your mobile phone effectively, so I think this probably warrants the most time of all the different segments that I'm presenting, just because I've got more of an IT and software engineering type background myself, because there was a ton of work done in this app just to make it work with this camera, because the camera is basically autonomous from your PC. It doesn't need any drivers or anything like that. It's all based on the OpSpot Start app. Once you install the application, it'll be found under OpSpot Start. So in my case, I've got a Galaxy Note connected to the PhoneLink app in Windows 11, just so I can show the screen, by the way, in case you're wondering why I can use a mouse with it. All right, so let me go ahead and make this window a little bit bigger so you can see things a little bit better. Okay, so this is the app that controls the camera. Now, this is pretty important because this is basically where you're gonna do most of the configurations to connect it to different services, to determine if you wanna run it as a UVC camera or a wireless camera. All of that stuff is done through the OpSpot Start app. So let me just go through some of the different controls here, and you're seeing a few of them already on the screen. So the one up here is the preview window, so you actually can see the full frame typically of the window when you are zooming into something, for example. So if I was to go into Zoom, you'll see that here's the preview of what that zoom will look like in the corner, but I can see the full frame underneath it, so I have an idea of what that zoom control looks like. Of course, I can do recording with this as well, so if I wanted to record, I could select where I want to record, if I want to record to SD media, or if I want to stream. In my case, I'm not going to record here, but I could record out to various different services. So if I wanted to also take a photo while I'm recording, I can even take a photo quickly by pressing that button. Now, something else that's important, obviously, because it's a gimbal camera, is the fact that I can control the camera by moving the joystick around. So let's say I want to move it left or right. I can do that here. I can move it down as well, and I can move it up if I want to. So all of these things I can do through the joystick control, basically the digital joystick. Okay, so once you go into the tracking, you'll see that it will track you within the frame, kind of like you'd expect it to, and you can actually determine what the speed is of that tracking. All right, and you can see here with the different controls that you have. So I have AI control here, and I can do a wide or close up if I want to, half body, full body, depending on how far the camera is away from me. I also have, with this control, the ability to go slow, or if I go slow, it's gonna move pretty slowly between one and the other. And if you see a little bit of artifacting on the screen, that's because of the PhoneLink app sharing my screen. It's nothing to do with the camera. And then fast, if I'm maybe wanting to move faster. If you've seen my other videos, this is closer to kind of how the experience is on the Insta 360, where it tends to be always fast, too fast in my opinion. But the slow and the standard here actually let you determine that. If you want to change the area to track, you can actually move the composition lines around to change your tracking area as well. Then when I close that out, you'll see that here I can set presets as well. So let's say I want to use the gimbal instead of the auto tracking. Now, I just showed you the gimbal before. So let's say I want to move this a little bit over here and set a preset. So now I've got preset one. So then if I'm over here, I can just hit preset one and it'll always move to that target where that preset is. Okay, so that's kind of the gimbal control and how to set a preset. If I want to zoom in as well, what I can do if I want to is zoom in. I can kind of move if I want to move that way and pan it over, which is kind of cool. If you've got like, if you want to pan to a different area kind of manually, you can do that too. If I wanted to set maybe a preset there with it zoomed in kind of close, kind of for a little bit of a dramatic shot, I could do that. And then if I go in and you can look in the preview what it's doing, if you go in, you can do that and you can preview, you can go zoom into something if you wanted to. Maybe if you wanted to do those crazy facial zoom shots on your streams or something, you could do all of that as well. So, and that's where you would plan for those and build those. If you want to delete any of these keys, by the way, you just long press and you'll see there's an ability to delete them and then add new presets. You can add up to 3 different presets. So if I keep going, this is where you can do different modes. So here I've got my presets. I've got an on-air, wide, and an auto shot. And face one, so you can basically switch which ones you want to go between, and this is actually the production shot. So if you go between the different shot, these are your last different modes that you're in, so you can basically switch between them, and this is kind of the switching mode if you're like a technical director or using OBS. These are like your scenes effectively that will let you switch between those different scenes that you're on in order to do that quickly while you're streaming live, which is pretty cool. All right, so now if I go into settings, here's where you can actually control the camera settings. You'll see this camera supports HDR, and when you do that, it tends to change the color profile a little bit. It didn't make it radically different as I was changing HDR. It was darkening the image when I was downstairs in my kitchen a little bit, but I was leaving it off for the most part. You have different modes in terms of the kind of color presets that you can do. With custom, that's where you can go into the camera itself and set its different settings for sharpness, contrast, saturation, hue, and brightness. So you have all those abilities. I'll go back to standard though, because I actually like the composition and the way the picture looks more or less kind of from the factory, the built-in way. I noticed that when I actually did go into the settings, and there are a few different settings. All right, so in terms of the settings in the camera, and these are all fairly important. So gesture control, you can use hand gestures. You can see I have select target where I'm basically waving at the camera with my full palm. That will let you select the target to find you and your face basically. And then I have the ability to record, so that will start and stop recording instead of using the record button, which is here. And then I have the ability, if I want to use this kind of zoom command, zoom in and zoom out, that will let me zoom in and out. And you can also do dynamic zoom by moving your hands in and out. Not sure if it'll do it while I'm in the settings mode, but that works as well. And you have direction flip that is available to you also. Now, some additional controls that you'll want to look at. If you have the built-in microphone, you can turn it on. You can also use, if you've got, like I said before, a 3.5 millimeter TRS microphone, you can plug those in too. Now, when I was changing the noise reduction settings, I was doing that here. Use audio output as well, and then your noise reduction settings. I liked 1 and 2. Right now I'm actually recording on my Shure MV7, so it doesn't matter, but I liked those different settings for audio from the camera. All right, the additional things that you can do, auto face exposure, and this is where it's basically tracking the center of the frame where the face is, and you could see it brightened up when I turned it off. I actually do think that the facial exposure towards the center of the frame makes for a very nice image by default. Of course, you can tune it a bit to your liking if you want to use those controls. Then you've got the ability to set upper and lower ISO limits if you want to do that. This one's important, so UVC mode. Right now, I have the camera turned on so that it will just wirelessly either broadcast over Wi-Fi or NDI or RTMP, etc. And I have the ability to turn it on UVC. Now, as I mentioned, when you go on UVC, and if you have like USB 3 or higher cable attached to it, it will consume a lot of power from that port on your computer, and you might not want to do it this way, depending on the settings that you have. One weird workaround that I found was to get a cable that wasn't USB, like USB 4 compatible, and at USB 2, which will do 1080p 60, it's not drawing as much power, therefore it's not able to kind of saturate that port from either a power or data perspective. I think it's more on the power and the charging side. I mean, the camera was pretty low on battery, so that might have been why it was drawing more power, but it did draw a lot of power for me when I was using it. When you switch on UVC mode, you'll see that by enabling it, it's going to turn off NDI recording, live streaming, HDMI, and RTSP. So you probably don't want to do that unless you know you're going on a cable. And again, just be careful in terms of the cable and how much power draw it's taking. Then we have RTSP mode, and then that means that if you turn that on, then basically your UVC, NDI, and live streaming will not be available once you turn on that type of streaming. All right, so one more thing I'm going to pop in, and I know I sounded a little bit bored, I think, while I was going through the app, but that's just how I am when I actually start to review apps, and you know, my voice kind of goes more into the pragmatic tones. But I did want to interrupt myself here because, you know, I was thinking as I recorded this, I didn't actually show how you set up the wireless stream itself. Now, what I did was I set up an RTSP stream into OBS. So that means that basically you would use that on the same Wi-Fi network as your computer that's running on OBS, or if it's on a wired Ethernet network, you'd use it over the same Ethernet. But basically, your device, that OBSpot Tail Air, has its own IP address, effectively, that you'll put in for the RTSP port, effectively. So what you do in that case for OBS, normally when you use media source, you do things like point it to a media file, like an MP4 or MOV file, and have it loop or do those kind of things. But when you uncheck the local file checkmark in OBS, then you can go in and actually put in the RTSP location details for the camera, which you'll find, by the way, in the camera under settings. And so once you do that, it will actually see it as if it's a running video from another source over the network. Another set of important settings, and I've set these down my frame rate to 50 hertz to kind of avoid the light LED light flicker behind me that you saw in the first shot. But you can encode at H.264 or 265. Frame rates, kind of the ones, the usual suspects that you are used to, 24, 25, 30, 48, 50, and 60. You can record at 4K or 1080p. And you can set different resolutions based on the output as well. So that's kind of cool that you can actually differ them. So for example, maybe you want a live stream on 1080p, for example, but you want to have a higher 4K resolution recording to your SD media or going to another stream. Well, that's something that you can configure here and differentiate. So those are all of the kind of important settings that you'll need to know in terms of the OBSpot app, and this is the main app that you're going to use to control and drive this camera pretty much, you know, when you're using it for Windows or Mac, if you want to attach it to those devices, or obviously live stream, you're going to do that through the camera itself and the app for mobile that's basically talking to the camera and configuring it for all the settings for your streams and those types of things. All right, so that's the OBSpot Tail Air, a fully wireless PTZ 4K camera with a really good image and also a very nice array of microphones on it. and a lot of capabilities, being able to save it to the SD card. And I mentioned, as I was kind of in my kitchen, is it backing up to the SD card? Yes, it was. So you've got full quality backup just in case something does happen during your stream, which is always nice. You've got HDMI out, which works as another port. You can do line level input for another microphone. You can monitor through headphones. So all these different things that you can do with this device, it's basically like a little computer in the base of that camera to be able to control it through your phone and also connect to Bluetooth accessories and those types of things. So a couple of things to point out, and you know, these were, I would say, the only two negative things that I found on the camera. One, like I said, it was drawing a ton of power over my USB-C port. It's basically drawing too many amps from the USB-C port when it was set to UVC camera. So my suspicion is it was trying to charge the battery and trying to draw a little bit too much amperage from those ports. So that's one thing to be aware of. The other thing is the device does get pretty hot. Like I said, there's a computer basically running in the base of that device. So it does get quite warm to the touch. I did, though, just because I wanted to test this out, and I'm a bit daring in terms of making sure everything's going to work, but I tested this out overnight. I actually left it on OBS, wirelessly connected to my OBS environment, and when I got back and tried it out in the morning, like after about 10 hours, it was still a live stream going on with my OBS environment. No freezing. It was completely up and running, motion, everything there. Of course, it charged the device fully by that time. So it does have a lot of stamina to it, even though it gets quite hot. Don't worry about it like overheating to the point where it's going to shut itself down with some kind of a thermal issue, because I ran it all night and it was fine. Otherwise, I would give it a recommendation. You know, if that's what you're in the market for and you need something that's very flexible, that's a great camera for something like this. And it basically does everything in one device. So if you like this video and you got value from it, be sure to give me a like. Also, because I just recently actually evaluated the OBSpot Tiny 2, I'd encourage you to check out this video on the screen, and thanks for watching.